So let's go ahead and start talking about chemical bonding. We talked about it some in other chapters, but now we really want to start drawing these molecules and putting them together and understanding how things actually come together. In order to be successful in this chapter, you should review the three types of chemical bonding. We're going to do that briefly here as well, but if you're confused, go back to the Module 3 content. You're going to need to be able to draw Lewis electron dot symbols for any atom or ion, and you should be able to recognize if something is covalently bonding or ionically bonding. Within that, we're going to get into the concepts of electronegativity and how these molecules are actually held together. So ionic and covalent bonding. Again, we just covered this in Module 3, so if you're confused, go back to your Module 3 content. But there are three types of chemical bonding: ionic bonding, covalent bonding, and the metallic bonding. Metallic is its own species. Metallic is just between metals, how metals stay together. But ionic and covalent is when you have different species bonded together, or in the case of covalent, also your diatomics and your polyatomic elements, where it's like P4, SE8, etc. Ionic bonding is that electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged particles. One piece has completely given its electrons away to another. So the sodium ion is formed by giving away an electron to a chlorine, as shown here. Now we have formed a sodium ion and a chloride ion. It is a full electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged particles. We have a cation, we have an anion. Covalent bonding is when we're sharing electrons. This is typically seen between nonmetals. It doesn't have to be a nonmetal. We're going to see in this chapter that it's all a spectrum of bonding, but typically observed between nonmetals. And it's neither element wants to give up their electrons, but they all want their octet. Everyone wants to reach the octet role, or in hydrogen's case, it's duet. And metallic bonding, the metal cations are sitting in a sea or ocean of electrons. We call this a sea of electron model. And this is typically seen between metal ions. Again, the properties of the elements and the compounds are consequences of the type of bonding exhibited. So you need to understand the types of bonding that's occurring so that you can understand why the molecules behave as they do. Bonds form when they lower the potential energy of the atoms or ions. It's an exothermic process. Energy is released. Lewis dot symbols. You should be able to draw the Lewis dot symbol for any species or any symbol. And so we see here, if we look at their electron configuration, it's pretty quick to figure out the Lewis dot symbol. Even if we don't look at we should be able to just tell by the number of valence electrons it has. A Lewis dot symbol is telling me, based on valence electrons, how many electrons are able to be lost, how many can be gained, or how many can be shared. So for lithium, we have one valence electron. Lithium is group 1. Group 1 has one valence electron. We see one dot. Beryllium is group 2. We see two dots. Boron is group 13, formerly group 3, three dots. Carbon, group 14, formerly group 4, four dots. Nitrogen, group 15, formerly 5, five dots. Oxygen, 16, fluorine, 17, neon, 18. And we see 6, 7, and 8 dots. Notice when we put the dots around the elements, we do them very intentionally. We put one dot on each side before we pair them up. Electrons will not pair up until they have to. We don't pair them up on here either. What I mean by that is I'm not going to write this. That would be incorrect. I can write this. I can write what's shown. I can write this. I can write this. All of these are valid, but the electrons do not pair up until they have to. The octet rule. Again, atoms tend to gain, lose, or share electrons in such a way to obtain the noble gas configuration, which is most often 8 electrons. It doesn't have to be 8. It could be more than 8. It could be, in hydrogen's case, in helium's case, less than 8, just 2. But generally speaking, the octet rule is what electron atoms are going to follow. So if I have sodium, it has one valence electron. I'm going to write one dot. Magnesium, two valence electrons, two dots. Aluminum, three valence electrons, three dots. Silicon, four valence electrons, four dots. Phosphorus, five valence electrons, one, two, three, four, Now I'm going to pair them up because I have to. Five dots. Sulfur, six valence electrons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm now pairing them up because I have to. And you, again, you can pair them up on it, the sides, whatever way makes more sense to your brain. As long as you have, I'm trying to make them just show that they're intentionally separated. As long as you have them only paired up when they have to be. Chlorine, seven valence electrons, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. And argon, 8 valence electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. So ionic and covalent bonding is a continuum. We say that molecules are ionic or covalent for simplicity, especially for naming simplicity, but the truth is it's not actually true. We could have purely ionic, we could have purely covalent, or we could have somewhere in between, and most atoms actually lie somewhere in between based on their electronegativity, which we're going to talk about very next. But ionic is when we have that full transfer of electron. Or electrons. In this case, sodium has given up an electron completely to the chlorine atom, forming a sodium ion and a chloride ion. We could have nonpolar covalent. Nonpolar covalent is equal sharing. Nonpolar means equal. Covalent means sharing. And polar covalent is unequal sharing of electrons. In the case of H2, the diatomic, they equally share their electrons. There's no reason for them not to. They have the same pull on the electrons. But if I have something like HCl, it is a molecular compound. They are sharing electrons, but they're not sharing them nicely. Chlorine is pulling the electron density more towards itself. So an unequal sharing of electrons. The chlorine is more electronegative than the hydrogen atom, so it's able to pull the electron density towards itself. And so as the cartoon shows here, anionic bond, hey Eugene, would you like a cookie? Just gives away the cookie. Covalent bond, let's split a cookie 50-50. Polar covalent bond, 7/8 for me, 1/8 for you, and unequal sharing. So what is this concept of electronegativity I keep talking about? Electronegativity is similar to electron affinity, but not exactly the same thing. Electron affinity is when an electron is added to an atom. Electronegativity is how strongly atoms are able to attract bonding electrons to themselves. So they're sharing, but it's like a tug of war. They're sharing this rope with another atom, but how much can they pull that rope towards themselves versus how much does the middle of the rope stay in the middle of the middle between the two atoms? Follows the trends of ionization energy. Higher electron affinity, more electronegative. The difference between the two, the difference between electronegativity and electron affinity, is that electronegativity is a chemical property that's describing how well an atom attracts the electrons towards itself, while electron affinity is the defines the amount of energy released when electrons added to a neutral atom. So an electron is not actually being added to an atom here. It's just an unequal sharing of electron density. Where one atom is really good at pulling electron density towards itself. Here's your trends. Again, we can see it increases as I go. Same trend as ionization energy increases across and up the table. You need to know that fluorine is number one at this game. Oxygen is number two at this game. Chlorine and nitrogen are tied in third place for the game. After that, you will follow the trend. But you are responsible for knowing fluorine is number one, oxygen is number two, nitrogen and chlorine are number three. Fluorine being number one isn't too hard to do, but the oxygen gets confused with the chlorine. Oxygen is number two, chlorine is number three, tied with nitrogen. You can see the numbers there. So what are the most electronegative elements? Fluorine, followed by oxygen, followed by carbon, followed by chlorine and nitrogen. The least electronegative? Down here. Cesium, francium. Again, electronegativity, the tendency of an atom participating in a bond to pull electron density towards itself. It's that unequal sharing of that electron density. They are technically sharing, but it's not sharing nicely. It's sharing very unequally. It's pulling more electron density towards itself, causing the atom that's more electronegative to be bigger, to have a bigger negative charge than the one that has more, and the other one having a partial positive charge. That's how water behaves. Water pulls electron density towards itself, causing the hydrogens to have a partial positive charge, the oxygen to have a partial negative charge, because the oxygen atom of the water molecule is more electronegative than the hydrogen, so it pulls it towards itself. So again, you can see the trends here, but you have to know these ones. And then after that, we follow the general trend always holds true.